Hello dear students, today we will be covering the topic circulatory system. It's an important organ system of the body. This organ system helps in the proper functioning of the body by distribution of various substances. It comprises of the heart, the blood vessels, the liquid blood, lymph and so on. So we will study this in detail now. So first of all, you need to study what is the need for circulatory system. The circulatory system is required for distribution of body heat. Especially in case of warm-blooded animals, they need to maintain a constant body temperature at all times. This is done with the help of the circulatory system. The blood will carry the heat everywhere uniformly in the body, keeping the body temperature constant. It helps in the removal of excess water by the process of osmoregulation. Osmoregulation is done by kidneys, but for kidneys to do this effectively, the blood needs to carry this to the kidneys, and again the need for circulatory system. It is required for distribution of hormones. The hormones are produced by endocrine glands, and endocrine glands secrete these hormones directly in blood. Blood will be carrying these to various places, especially producing their effect on the target organs. Again, the need for circulatory system. It is required for removal of nitrogenous waste. Nitrogenous waste like urea, uric acid, creatinine are removed out in the urine with kidneys. But again, blood needs to take it to the kidneys. It is required for transportation of respiratory gases like oxygen. Needs to be given to the tissues, carbon dioxide needs to be removed out. This can be done by blood, but again, the requirement of circulatory system. It is required for transport of digested nutrients. After the digestive system has digested the nutrients, digested the food, the nutrients which are absorbed, they need to be sent to various areas. This is done with the help of circulatory system. Now, what are the various principal fluids in the body which will bring about all these functions? There are three primary fluids. One is the blood, which is the main fluid in the body, which is pumped by heart. The second is the lymph. The lymph is a straw-colored liquid. It is not pumped by any organ, but it flows in lymph vessels. The third one is the tissue fluid. The tissue fluid is basically the fluid which is present in and around tissue spaces. So wherever in between blood and lymph are not able to reach, those areas are flooded by tissue fluid. So the three fluids collectively are responsible for distribution of all the aforesaid substances uniformly in every part of the body. Now, when you are doing this, you need to do the two concepts of open and closed circulatory system. In very simple form, an open circulatory system is that in which the heart pumps the blood to the vessels, but the vessels do not directly open back in the heart. They open in spaces around the organs. So the blood is not confined to vessels or to various tubes. It flows in open spaces, and these open spaces are called sinuses. Now, here the blood has a special name. It is called as hemolymph, because here it is not directly having hemoglobin, the common pigment present in mammalian blood. And in case of closed circulatory system, like the system which we have, the heart directly pumps the blood to vessels, and these will be carried back to the heart. So the blood never gets a chance to come in open spaces around the organs. So this kind of a system is found in higher mammals. It is found in birds and fishes also, but this is the kind of circulatory system which is closed, where the blood never comes in open spaces. But when the blood comes in open spaces around the organs, it is called as open circulatory system. So the open circulatory system is basically found in insects, honeybees, locusts, crabs, prawns, lobsters. And the closed circulatory system is found in all fishes, in case of birds, animals, primates. So all mammals and higher animals, they have the closed circulatory system. Now, besides the circulating fluids, you have certain non-circulating fluids also. The fluids which are used and produced at the same point where they originally are present. They do not circulate in the entire body. For example, the vitreous and the aqueous humor. They are found in the eye, they remain in the eye, they do not go anywhere from the eye. The aqueous humor is found in front of the lens. This white structure which you are seeing is the lens. The aqueous humor is found here. The vitreous humor is found behind the lens. This is the lens and this is the vitreous humor. We will be doing more about the structure of the eye in the chapter sense organs. So the aqueous and the vitreous humor again are examples of non-circulating fluids. Then the next non-circulating fluid is the synovial fluid. The synovial fluid is present in between the joints of bones. This is a straw-colored liquid. It is found wherever two bones are present in contact and are moving. Wherever the body has a movable joint, we will have the synovial fluid. The synovial fluid basically prevents any kind of friction between the bones. So this synovial fluid is found only in between the movable joints. It is a non-circulating fluid. The circulating fluids you have already done are blood, lymph, and the tissue fluid. The blood flows in the arteries, capillaries, and the veins. The lymph flows in lymph vessels, and the tissue fluid present in and around the tissue spaces. The tissue fluid basically is present around every tissue. It is nourishing every tissue from outside. So these three become the circulating fluids in the body. Blood, as you are doing, it is pumped by the heart and flows through the three chambers, three blood vessels, which are the arteries, capillaries, and the veins. The blood is pumped by the heart, which has four chambers. So the heart will be pumping the blood into the arteries. Arteries will be carrying it to organs via the capillaries. Capillaries will collect and form a vein, and vein will pour the blood back in the heart. So the blood never gets a chance to come in open spaces. Therefore, the kind of circulatory system which humans have is called as a closed circulatory system. Now, what are the properties of blood? The blood is never stationary. As you have seen that the heart pumps the blood, the beating of heart is 72 to 80 beats per minute. That many times the entire volume of blood which is in the heart is pumped to various areas. So the blood is never stationary. It can be bright red or dark red. It is bright red when it has oxygen. It is dark red when it has carbon dioxide. So it is the color is variable depending upon presence or absence of oxygen and carbon dioxide. The volume of blood is 5 to 6 liters. It is lower in females and higher in males. Males generally are broader and taller, so the number of length of blood vessels is a little longer, hence capacity of blood is more. It is saltish to taste with a pH of 7.3 to 7.4. Now, why is the pH slightly higher than the neutral pH? Because of presence of certain alkali salts, like salts of sodium. So therefore, it has a slightly higher pH. Now, the various functions of blood. Blood helps in transport of various substances like the digested food. Whatever we have digested in the body, it is transported via the blood. It helps in the transportation of oxygen as oxyhemoglobin. The formula of oxyhemoglobin is Hb.O2. The dot is needed to indicate its loose chemical combination. So oxyhemoglobin. It transports carbon dioxide as carbamino hemoglobin. It is carbon dioxide which is transported by hemoglobin. So when it is oxyhemoglobin, it is bright red. When it is carbamino hemoglobin, it is dark red. It helps in the removal of and transportation of excretory material. The blood also helps in distribution of hormones and of heat. So all these are the primary functions of blood. Besides this, the blood provides protection. The blood helps in formation of a clot when we are injured. If you ever have an open injury, at that point, after some time, a clot will be formed. The clot formation prevents excessive loss of blood from an injury. So that's a protective function afforded by blood. It is brought about by blood platelets. We will be studying it in detail later. The second function which is done by blood is it helps in engulfing bacteria by the process of phagocytosis. Bacteria are engulfed by various kinds of WBCs. WBCs are also one type of blood component. They engulf the bacteria, and this process is called as phagocytosis. Besides this, the blood has another function. It produces antitoxins and antibodies. Now, what are antitoxins and what are antibodies? When any germ enters your body, the germ produces certain chemicals called toxins. These toxins can affect their host cell. The host cell can be any cell in the body, and the host cell is destroyed by these toxins. To prevent this from happening, the WBCs prepare antitoxins. These antitoxins destroy the toxins, thereby the host cell remains healthy. So to counter toxins, the WBCs produce antitoxins. And what are antibodies? When any germ cell, any pathogen enters your body, the coating of the pathogen has a chemical substance called antigen. In response to that, the WBC called lymphocyte produces antibodies. These antibodies will destroy the pathogen by covering the antigen. So the antibodies are produced in response to the germ. The antitoxins are produced in response to the toxins. Both of these are protective functions of blood. We will be doing this in detail further on also. But for now, you need to remember that antitoxins are produced in response to toxins. Antibodies are produced in response to antigens on the pathogen. And both of them are protective functions of blood. So collectively, your blood has these three protective functions. It prepares a clot on the injured site. The WBCs engulf bacteria by phagocytosis. It produces antitoxins and antibodies. Then what is the composition of blood? The blood basically has two parts. The liquid part of blood is called as plasma. It's a straw-colored liquid in which certain formed elements are present. And what are the formed elements? There are three formed elements in the human blood. RBCs or erythrocytes. They are the red blood cells, which are biconcave in shape on maturity. We have WBCs, leukocytes, white blood cells. It is these WBCs which perform antibody, antitoxin formation function or help in the protective function by producing any kind of eating mechanism by process of phagocytosis when the germs are eaten. And the third one is platelets, the thrombocytes. The platelets are the ones which are responsible for blood clotting. So these are the various components of blood. We will be doing the further components in detail in the next video. This was the general overview of blood. Hope you have understood it all. Thank you very much, and God bless you all.